imagine experiencing the soundtracks of your favorite games wirelessly. That's exactly what I've managed to do with my GameBoy.
Hi there, and welcome back to Can We Fix That? The place where electronics get a second life and sometimes a whole new evolution. I'm Markus, and today I'm taking you on a journey to explore how I accomplished this mod and why I spent several days and countless of hours on it before it finally worked. This piece of innovative modding you are seeing comes from Macho Nacho Productions, Tito's channel. His work is not just creative, but also a great source of inspiration. Tito's Bluetooth mod for the GameBoy caught my eye, but I saw an opportunity to take it a step further. I asked myself, can we integrate Bluetooth functionality directly into the Game Boy without any external additions like 3D printed parts? Can we give it a built-in control system to power it on and off and start pairing all while maintaining the Game Boy's original aesthetics? That is the challenge I set out to tackle.
The key part of this integration was the Game Boy's brightness button. I wanted to use this existing button not only for its original purpose, but also to control the new Bluetooth module. Initially, I tried using a 555 timer IC, a small chip designed to measure time intervals. It was meant to detect button presses within a set time frame for the Bluetooth module. But this approach was too simplistic. The Game Boy mod required precise control to distinguish between different types of button presses, a complexity beyond what the 555 timer could handle effectively.
This realization led me to choose a more sophisticated solution, a microcontroller. The ATTiny85 from Atmo was ideal to its compact size and capabilities. It was perfect for detecting the nuanced press patterns of the brightness button and controlling the Bluetooth module accordingly.
Unlike basic components, it needed in-depth coding to realize our vision. Now this microcontroller acts as the brain of our mod, integrating smoothly with the Game Boy's interface and elevating its interactivity to a new level. Here we go, the clock's ticking. It's time to embark on the Game Boy mod adventure. Let's see how this old classic blends with our new tweaks. After opening it up, it's time to skillfully separate the screen from the upper case. We'll be using a prying tool, applying just the right amount of pressure. It's all about the finesse here. Looks like we have found the ideal home for our Bluetooth module. However, to make space for it, we must eliminate this foamy layer. We will use some IPA, our fingernails, a prying tool, cotton swabs, and plenty of patience for this task. And just like that, the foam is history. Now it's time to bring in the star of the show, our Bluetooth module. If you listen closely, you will catch the click of the pairing button on our Bluetooth module. Turns out it's a tad too thick for our needs, but no worries, we will simply remove this button later to slim it down. For this soldering, I've chosen thin color-coded wires, much like in headphones. Just look at how these slender wires compare to the thicker ones I normally use in my projects. Now it's time to gently sand away the insulation on these thin wires, all under the watchful eye of our trusty microscope camera. Let's solder the wires as needed and then trim off any extra length to keep things neat and tidy. Next, we focus on achieving a stable 5-volt output for our setup. Following Tito's lead, I've opted for the gaming port, as seen in his video. But hold on to your gadgets, I will soon reveal why this might be a bit of a tech hiccup for our setup. Post-soldering the power and ground wires, we make a smooth transition to the audio wiring, focusing on the left and right channel. You're hearing it correctly, this isn't your internal speaker's mono jam, but a stereo symphony, all thanks to the Bluetooth mod. Alright, here's the plan. Connect the brightness button straight to the Bluetooth module's pairing pin. But it's not all plug and play. We've got to play a mini game of
white pin
on the button first. Hope it's ready for its close-up. Let's see.
Here we go!
After uniting the pairing pin with the Bluetooth module through the magic of solder, it's time to put this setup to the test without the microcontroller. Let's load in the retro Mega Man cartridge and reattach the screen to try it out. Shortly into the battery and flip the power switch. Device status, on and explosion free. Phew! Up next on our tech adventure, pairing it with a Bluetooth speaker to fill the room with some delightful melodies. Speaker set to matchmaking mode. Check. And here's the fun part. Our module goes into looking for love, also known as auto pairing mode, unless it's already committed to another Bluetooth gadget. Here we are, grooving to Mega Man's old school beats, but uh-oh, there's an uninvited guest. Background noise. But more on that later. Let's test if initiating the pairing process is possible by pressing the GameBoy's brightness control button. It should theoretically trigger, as we have directly soldered it to the Bluetooth module's pairing pin. Oops, what was that? Let's try this again. Take 2, let's give this button another press. Despite our crafty soldering, this brightness button is currently more of a do nothing button. No screen light, no Bluetooth pairing. Under the microscope, we go for a mini repair mission. Turns out, in a bit of a facepalm moment, I swap the left and right channels while soldering, and that's with color-coded wires. Oh my goodness. After completing this task, we need to find a suitable solder pad connected to the brightness button, bearing in mind that directly soldering onto the button itself is not considered best practice. We will use a multimeter in continuity mode to identify the correct connection point. Let's proceed with soldering the wire to this pad, ensuring precision and neatness to satisfy my inner monk. The very next day.
Okay, and some stretching.
Okay guys, back to business. I measured around and discovered why the brightness button was not functioning after connecting it to our module's pairing pin. Let me show you. The voltage of the brightness pin is 4.3 volts, typically it's 5 volts, but the battery was slightly depleted, which I assume is why it's lower. The pairing pin's voltage stands at 2.8 volts, typically at 3.3 volts, which can also be attributed to the battery's condition. This brings us to the second issue, the discrepancy in voltages.
Linking up the GameBoy and Bluetooth module to one button sets the stage for a voltage dilemma. The GameBoy buzzes on 5 volts, but the Bluetooth module's pairing process is more a 3.3 volt fan. This means a button press gets lost in translation. The signal never zeroes out. Cue the ATTiny85, acting as our diplomatic middleman. It's cool with the GameBoy's 5 volts and still knows how to handle the Bluetooth module. With the ATTiny85, we bridge the gap, ensuring both devices get the message loud and clear, regardless of their voltage preferences.
Here you see my test setup with the through-hole version of the ATTiny85. This was excellent for experimenting, but for the mod itself, we need a smaller version of it. To the left is the through-hole version, while the right features the SMD version, distinctly smaller when compared directly. To use it, we need to desolder it from its USB programmer, onto which I've already uploaded our little program. We'll use hot air for this. The plastic pin headers will melt during this process, but that's fine since we don't need them. Now the difference is even more apparent. The moment has arrived to solder all essential components. At the video's conclusion, I will provide all the details and components required for you to replicate this. Navigating through this part was like trying to solve a Rubik's Cube in the dark. No PCB for soldering and trying to keep it tiny and tidy, which was honestly a bit fiddly. Surviving the soldering marathon that felt longer than a dentist appointment, let's examine the outcome of our efforts after more than 90 minutes of diligent work. Once again, it's time for Mega Man. Before we get carried away with the next step, let's do a quick sound check to see if our audio gremlin is still hanging around. As you can clearly hear, the sound is even worse than in our previous tests. Without high quality audio transmission, the entire project is doomed.
They're doomed.
Yes. At that point, I hit a bit of a brain teaser, dabbling in trial and errors like a lost chef in a kitchen. Time to call in the cavalry. Hello, community helpers.
Post soundcheck, it's no secret that our Game Boy mod's audio trouble has hit a new low. I reached out for your savvy in a short video, and boy did you deliver. Drowning issues, you say? Sounds like a solid lad. Cheers for the pointer. Let's roll up our sleeves and see if grounding tweaks do the trick. With your collective wisdom fueling this mission, I'm feeling pretty upbeat. Let's crack this audio conundrum and don't go anywhere. Your support is the magic ingredient here.
A few days later. Armed with this information, I decided it would be wise to inspect the wiring. More accurately, to completely redo the wiring. I purchased some thicker copper wire for added reliability. I whipped out my backup Bluetooth module from the testing playground. And now it's showtime for the desoldering wizardry. Out with the old wires. The task at hand is to rewire using the newly acquired copper wire with a focus on the ground connections. Bridging the audio ground AGND with the power ground PGND is anticipated to be the appropriate approach. With the soldering done, we will bring in the multimeter for a quick detective check, making sure every connection is in the successful club. All that's left is to buddy up these new wires with the GameBoy PCB and cross our fingers for sweet sounds before I start filling out asylum applications as a new hobby. Okay, it's time for another round of switching the power button to the on position.
Wish me luck, guys!
Wow, it's like a not-so-golden thread weaving through this video. The sound is still a hot mess. This leads us to suspect what I initially thought was a minor issue. Perhaps I was mistaken.
I almost missed a crucial hint in the comments of my help-seeking videos. Kudos to Pablo Jill, and I hope I've got that pronunciation right, for spotlighting an unexpected suspect, our power button. Could its tendency to attract grime, coupled with a potentially weak power line, be the source of our audio issues? This theory is definitely worth exploring. Thanks for the heads up, Pablo. Let's get our hands dirty and find out, shall we?
Alright, let's open up the power button to take a look inside. We will need a soldering iron, solder wick, and a tool to pry it open.
Wow, that looks horrible. Okay, that could definitely be a reason. Wow.
You heard right, this could be the culprit. Let's see if we can clean out this dirt. A cotton swab with IPA is just not cutting it. Time to level up with a grinding pan to conquer that nefarious grime layer.
Have a look.
Not sure if it's a magic fix, but a little isopropyl alcohol bath won't do any harm while we're giving that button a makeover. With the power button all spruced up from sanding, it's time to rebuild and solder its shield back onto the PCB. Here's hoping we've just added the final spice to our sound recipe. Alright, time to flip this bad boy over and hit the on switch. Seems like I'm becoming a pro at this. Now let's switch speakers. Who knows, maybe the old one was just having a bad day and giving us grief. Oh no, the timer tracking our session is running low on battery. Wow, we're almost 4.5 hours in. No wonder it's out of power. By the way, if you like what I'm doing here, please hit the like button. It really helps me reach more people. Thank you. To make sure the button maintains a good connection after our treatment, we will keep tolling it for several seconds. Let's connect it to this speaker and hope for the best.
I think I can still hear it.
In a desperate move, I desoldered the ground wire from the shielding, which should have been a proper grounding, but you never know, and then reconnected it to another ground pad like this one you see here. Let's power up the speaker and wait for those noisy tunes to harass my ears. Could this be real? The sound is as clear as a bell, no noise inside. Thank you very much, guys, for pushing me in the right direction. You are awesome! Time to circle back to the module with those slender wires and our microcontroller set up from the beginning of this adventure. Reattach the wires, but given our grounding saga, a bit of a logic shuffle in the components was needed.
I'll quickly go over this part to avoid getting too technical. Another 40 minutes of soldering down, and I'm starting to harbor a quiet hope that we might just pull this off as intended.
Well, to be honest, I'm not quite sure if it works.
Cheer up, Lumet Markus. Let's see your smile. Optimism is the name of the game. How about this? We get everything assembled, snuck in its case, and only then do we give it the grand reveal in all its glory.
Hopefully, we are done.
After clocking in over 7 hours, we have hit a new record. This is by far the longest recording session on this channel. Okay, here we go, the big reveal. Slipping in Mega Man for the ultimate test and powering up this jam. Fingers crossed. A long press should power the module on or off.
Brightness button.
As you can see, the Bluetooth module is in off mode at the moment, just taking a brief siesta. All it takes is a nice long press of the brightness button to bring it to life. Now, the chance to get those beats flowing wirelessly to our Bluetooth speaker, aiming for peak crispness and sound. And let's be honest, our imagination sets some high bars, right? Okay, that's on the louder side, but honestly, no funky sound artifacts to be found. It's sounding pretty great. A double press should activate pairing mode. Testing my no artifacts claim, let's give my Bose headphones a whirl instead of the speaker. A quick double press and we are back in business with pairing mode. Hey folks, how neat is this? Running the whole show with just the brightness button, like a magic trick. I've got to admit I'm pretty chuffed with its performance.
Nice. No noise. Nice long press to disable it.
But I still owe you an explanation.
Ooh.
I promise to reveal why the GameLink power pin can be tricky in certain situations. Tito's videos correctly identify it as a 5V pin, but there's a catch. This only applies when you are playing classic GameBoy games. Switch to a GameBoy Advance game and it drops to 3.3 volts. This is by design to different specifications. I found a better pin that provides a steady 5 volts, perfect for our needs. You can find all the details, including components and source code, on the GitHub Project page. Link is in the description. After a few days, I discovered a crack in my case. I'm not sure why it suddenly appeared, but it seems the module is a bit too thick. It's not perfect yet, so if you have any ideas or tweaks, please drop a comment below and maybe we can bring it to perfection. If you are looking for more simpler GameBoy Advance SP mods, don't miss this video. Thanks for all your support and insights, and as always, happy tinkering!